Hello, everyone. I'm Blake West, and I want to welcome you. And I want to thank you all for being here with us today as we celebrate the life of Bob LuPone. It is impossible to capture the fullness of such a big life, such a big personality as Bob's in 1 hour with the remembrances of a dozen people. But today we're going to hear from some of the people who bore witness to what Bob did, who he was, what he created, and what he leaves behind. And because Bob was amazingly consistent in the way that he showed up, always Bob, always himself, no matter who he was with, where he was, what the circumstances were, we think that you'll recognize in our stories and tributes the Bob that you knew. But first I'd like to make a few acknowledgments and then I'll make some remarks of my own. There are many people to thank who we've acknowledged in the printed program, which I hope you all have, and if you don't, you can get either on the way back or flag down one of the ushers and they'll get one for you. But I would like to take a moment to give a special thanks to the incredible team here at Juilliard. Bob trained here as a dancer, and it was really important for us to do his memorial here, and we are thrilled and grateful that they were able to make that happen for all of us. And I also want to thank my colleagues at MCC Theater, which is, of course, the theater company that Bob co-founded with Bernie Telsey in 1986, and co-led with Bernie and Will Cantler until his death last August. The team at MCC has been an incredible part of putting together what we have here today. A lot of people have asked how they can honor Bob and where they might be able to contribute in his name. And after talking with his family and with initial help from the King Family Foundation and other generous donors, we've established at MCC the Bob LuPone Artistic and Audience Development Fund that will honor him in perpetuity. And if you are so moved as to participate or you would like more information, that's also in the program in the inside front cover. And now, Bob's life was expansive. He was, among many things, first and foremost, a dancer. He was also an actor and a very good one. He was an educator, a mentor to so many people, countless, more than we know, an artistic director, a loving husband to Virginia, a proud father to Orlando. He was a dreamer and a good friend. He did not compartmentalize the many parts of his life. He did not divide attention among any of these things. And it was that continuity of his attention and all that it made, to all of it, that it made Bob, Bob. Whether you were sitting with him in a conference room or in a rehearsal room, in the audience of a performance, at dinner, sitting with him the last time I saw him in his home upstate in Athens, it was Bob speaking his mind, sharing his ideas, his opinions, some of which were informed by facts and experience. Being totally impossibly charming, sometimes showing his impatience, and always expressing his love. I met Bob in 2006, and I had the privilege to work alongside him in my role as executive director at MCC. I also had the great joy of having Bob's friendship. I can say Bob was fun to work with, as I'm sure you could imagine. He was playful, curious. He was straightforward, which is actually a very nice way of saying he had absolutely no filter. That is a quality that was endlessly fascinating, often amusing, generally quite frustrating. He didn't take himself too seriously, even as he took the work and the process of creating something very seriously. both of which were really amazing qualities. He was all about the journey, not the destination. The process was key. That's where you learned the important things along the way. Whenever Bob arrived at the office, if I saw him off in the distance, I knew it was going to be a while from him to get from where he was and then to me. He had to do his walkabout. He'd buzz about the office. He would be stopping at everyone's desks, checking in, and really checking in. He wanted to know what was going on with everybody, and not about the work. He wanted to know what was going on with them, about their lives, with a big smile, lots of enthusiasm. How are you? How are you really? Are you taking care of yourself? Are you doing things you love? You're doing great. It was always laughter. Sometimes it sounded like a party. And I think it's a testament to Bob that so many former staff members from MCC are here today. And I don't just mean recent former staff members. I mean like way back decades and people who live pretty far away. And I don't mean, you know, New Jersey or Philadelphia. Oklahoma, Arizona, like they had to get on a plane to be here, places like that. Bob enjoyed a good debate. Lots of people probably know this, but I actually think he liked an argument even more. The stakes are higher in an argument. So it made more dramatic sense. In such an event, he could be thick-headed and excitable. And he blamed all of this on the fact that he was Italian. Bob was also someone who was incredibly perceptive about the nuances of character and personality. And I don't just mean in a play, in the text of a play, but in real live human beings, which is probably what made him good at his job as an artistic director, as an actor, as a teacher. But oddly, Bob could also have an extraordinary amount of trouble reading the room and picking up on certain cues. So this all converges for me. If you'll indulge me, I want to tell a little story. This all converges for me around Bob's dancing, actually. Specifically, his interpretive dancing. I don't know how many people know this. Bob loved to interpretive dance. Several years ago, my husband Billy and I were visiting Bob in Virginia and Orlando for the weekend. And on Saturday night, sometime after dinner, we were hanging out in the wonderfully warm living room of their house and that Bob was very proud of and spent a fair amount of time rebuilding. But we were sitting there and Bob jumps up and announces, apropos of nothing, that he is going to dance me. He is going to interpret my personality in dance. So now, on the one hand, I knew that I should be flat. My friend is going to make something for me. My friend is Zach from A Chorus Line. So the 14-year-old version of me, the musical theater-loving 14-year-old kid who listened to the original Broadway cast album on a loop over and over and over again for months and drove my family crazy, that kid would have been beside himself. That kid, me, I would have been eating that up. But at this point, Bob and I know each other pretty well. So when he says he's going to do an interpretive dance of my personality, I am shocked. And I think, don't you know me at all? Obviously, my personality is one that would prefer that you pick someone else. But there was no one else. I'm looking at Virginia and Orlando. It's Virginia, Orlando, Billy, and me. So it's me. So Bob points his laser at me and starts to dance, starts to move around what becomes this epic living room recital. He is navigating the furniture. He's finding open spaces. He's moving his body. This thing is endless, by the way. He's moving his body, like this story. He's moving his body in ways that are I had to admit, beautiful and surprising. And when he's done, he wants to talk about it. Of course he wants to talk about it. So we did. And because Bob loved to give notes and feedback, I decided I would offer some of my own. He defended the choices he made vigorously. To him, no, it was not too long. It made complete sense. And it was not the least bit unflattering, which I'm still not sure about. And you know what? I had to admit, I was loath to admit, I was very reluctant to admit, that Bob was right. I was found out. I was exposed. He saw me. He saw you too. I'm sure right now he sees all of us. Virginia and I were recently talking about this particular interest, pastime, talent of Bob's. And I just want to share what she told me because I think it's really important. And this is a direct quote. Bob's interpretive dancing got us kicked out of a lot of parties. So if you'll indulge me, I just have a couple of other brief things I want to share. The first is an excerpt from one of the many emails and letters that we received after Bob's death. We received nearly 900 correspondence, and we've collected them. We're collecting them in a book for Virginia and Orlando. And if you want to be included in this, there's some information on the back of your program. I think it's on the back cover. And please send something in. It would be really special to have you be a part of that. But this particular email that we received, I think really captures another quality of Bob's that I loved, and I loved so many and loved him so much. But this incident is from several years ago, from a donor, this email is from a donor at MCC. As we were walking out of the theater, there was a guy standing outside with a sling bag over his shoulder with records inside. When he saw Bobby, he took out a vinyl record of a chorus line and asked Bobby to sign it. Then, once Bobby had, the guy simply walked away without saying thanks. I remarked, it must be really nice to be remembered like that, but that guy didn't even say thank you. Bobby smiled and said, oh, I see that guy a lot. That album will be on eBay tomorrow. When I asked Bobby why he did it, he simply said, it takes just a few seconds of my time and that guy gets a chance to make a couple of bucks. That incident told me a lot about Bob LuPone. In my last visit with Bob shortly before he died, we were sitting together in his living room where he had done that interpretive dance, and we were looking at some old photographs with Virginia and Billy. And they were amazing. Bob is a kid on Long Island, kind of out and about. There was another of him as a boy, the only boy in a dance class, which was amazing. This photograph is unbelievable. There was a picture of him and the cast of A Chorus Line in those iconic gold costumes from the finale. And they're standing with Sir Laurence Olivier. Bob is right next to Laurence Olivier. And then there was this photo from before A Chorus Line, and it's Bob outside, evidently in motion, with long, dark, wavy hair and a mustache. And he's reaching up in this elegant arc, up high to the sky. And as we looked at the pictures, we were talking about dancing and Bob's relationship to dancing, which apparently for him was not about expressing what your body could do, but about pushing your body into what it couldn't do, overcoming the body's natural limitations to create something beyond what you would or could expect in order to create something beautiful and surprising. And that's indeed what he did.
In 1981, I was a 20-year-old NYU student and Bobby LuPone was my acting teacher. His method was a mishmash of stuff that I'm sure he thought he gleaned from this building. He was a dancer. But crazy other things that he got from the actor's studio where he was studying acting at the time. They were ego-destroying exercises designed to strip the student of their layered defenses to reveal the golden core of truth within. Class typically ended with a distraught young person alone on stage, having just raged for 40 minutes at an invisible parent in a folding chair, exposing the most intimate secrets and weeping. Good work, Bobby. It was very messy. Tears and snot, even cruel at times, verging on the abusive. And we fucking loved it. We loved Bobby. However, NYU did not. And he was not asked to return to teach the following semester. So seven of us in the original class of about 13 or 14 decided to hire him privately. Bernie, myself, Deb, Jana, Joe, Lori, and Larry. We paid him $50 a month, and for which Bobby provided two of these crazy acting classes a week, and once a week we would read a play, classic, contemporary, anything, meeting in his apartment, in his office, which was painted black, floor and ceiling. He had a black box theater in his apartment. Later, he revealed that he had saved the salary that we gave him in an account, an investment in the future company he envisioned we'd become. Spoiler alert, this was MCC. Growing up on Staten Island, I had no one who could guide me, who could show what it took to live a life in the arts. And Bobby was my first best guide, my Virgil, my Willy Wonka. Visiting him this past summer, he was frail, but I wanted him to voice some characters in an animated series that I was writing, with monsters and oddities and things. And Bobby was played a kindly Bigfoot dad character and a zombie. His reading of the word brains was particularly compelling. We had no money, I told him, but it is my intention to eventually pay the actors. And he said, donate it to MCC. So when young people ask me what they should do to begin their careers in the arts, in the theater, my go-to response is, get your friends together, the waiters, the temps, and read a play every day, every week. Find a Bobby. And that is no easy task. So what I'd like to say to all of us here who have had the great good fortune to have been influenced by Robert LuPone, make it easier to find a Bobby by being a Bobby. Look for opportunities to volunteer our time to nurture the generation that comes after us. And Bobby was not that much older than we were. I could literally teach a class of 50-year-olds at a senior center right now, would be equivalent. But really, anybody in need, any age, in need of encouragement, inspiration, a healthy dose of honest criticism, the tearing away of fears and defenses to reveal their golden core of truth like Bobby did. Thank you.
The first time I met Bobby LuPone, I thought Bernie Telsey was really nice.
Look, Orlando, buddy, I'm not saying he was mean. He wasn't mean.
He was Bobby. And he was miffed at me, and for a good reason. It was 1987, it was the second year of MCC. MCC was still in diapers, and Bobby was in many ways, except I think Will was also, but Bobby in many ways was the only adult in the room. And the room, it was a dingy, aging, second floor rehearsal space above the Nadhorn on Theater Row, and I was a kid, all of 25. And Joseph Brodsky, the great poet, wrote, a tear is the anticipation of the eye's future. And if I'm weep, it's because
We don't have Bobby here in physical form. So forgive me. I was a kid of 25. It was the first reading, not in my living room, of a full-length play I'd ever written. And it was supposed to be the very intimate gathering for the artistic staff. And I think, because I was just so nervous, I just wanted everybody to love my play. I invited 40 or 50 friends. The reading went great. I mean, my friends thought it was great. And by the way, it's an amazing story that I don't have time to tell, but if you're willing to make a meaningful donation to MCC and Bobby's honor and memory, I will come to wherever you are and I will give you all the details. The cast, there's so much here that I can't even unpack, believe me. I thought the reading went great. My friends loved it. Bernie, and so nice, and Will was so nice, and they brought me over to meet the Bobby LuPone. And he was handsome and confident with his arms crossed. He was a man. And he came at me with blunt words. He did not get what was going on. Who were all these people? There are a lot of details. If you do that special telling the story, take this to another level. I'm skipping. He came at me really hard. And I think because he wondered, you know, was I in need of a fan club? Or did I want a theater to call home? And I wanted the home. I didn't remember this part till Patrick told me that Jan Herzenberg told him. But it was in this moment when Bobby went after me, like, what am I doing, what am I thinking, that Jana told Patrick, and I'm going to now tell you, it's not in the script, that was a moment when I became a playwright. Because I stood up for myself, and I tried to explain these were my friends, and if you get me, you get them, and I probably didn't say I just wanted you to like my play. And to Bobby's credit, and this was Bobby's great gift, he could come at you hard, but he trafficked in the truth, his truth, and it was often the truth, and he was open and interested, and I knew that in this moment, he was open and interested in helping me find mine. It's hard to talk about Bobby just as Bobby, because Bobby was never ever only just about Bobby. I'm very proud of that line. The line came because it's days and days of trying to figure out how to talk about Bobby, and it's very hard. And what I realized, all I really want to do, and I'm just going to do this, I'm going to kind of throw my script out the window, is Orlando, if you may, if I may, you're just a little younger than I was when I met Bobby, and I just want you to know what it was like. To have my life irrevocably altered and changed by him. It first started because he hit me hard, but then when I tried to stand up for myself, I could feel that he would receive me and respect me. The one thing that was so clear about Bobby, and you see it in the photo on the program, and I saw it in the photo at the last miscast, the last time I saw Bobby, he had that same grin. Bobby loved. He loved the theater, he loved us. He loved his students who became his peers. He loved. He wasn't always lovable. I think it's a pretty good line, not as good as the earlier one. But I had to do it because it's in the script. He could be tough, he was hard-headed, but this is what I loved most about Bobby. He was a fighter, and I don't think he was looking for a fight. I really don't. I think he was always willing to fight. For the first-time playwright, the underseen and underused actor, for his students who would later become his peers, for MCC, for your beloved mother, and for you. Bobby, at his frequent best, was always about something bigger than himself. And that, to me, is the great lesson of his majestic and glorious life. And the secret beauty, of course, about Bobby, behind that tough guy exterior, he had this giant heart. And as much as he maybe didn't always want you to see it, it just couldn't help but escape.
I could do a whole riff on sometimes when Bobby would give me notes on a script. Wow, sometimes those notes, ouch. And yet, what I loved, and this is what he got to where he'd say, this is probably a terrible idea, this may be a bad idea, but he would offer it. He would offer it. And then if you chewed it down, 5 minutes later, he'd offer another. And the thing that was so beautiful about Bobby is he didn't need to be right. He just didn't want us to get it wrong. And so when I think of those early days, those amazing early MCC days, and so many of you were there then, who are here tonight, it was such an amazing, fertile, playful, dangerous, exciting time. I wondered, you know, sometimes it must have been a burden for Bobby, you know, to feel at times that he needed to be the smartest person in the room. You know, but what was beautiful about your dad is that over time, he went from needing to be the smartest person in the room to being one of the people who made sure there was a room. And those early rooms weren't so pretty. The new rooms are really nice, really nice, but they always had love and there was always permission, and he gave me and so many other people permission, and it made all the difference. So I just want to say thank you, Bobby, for always making room. And I'll finish with this. The last time I spoke with Bobby, there was too much to say and not enough time. I wanted to thank him for changing my life. And I took it upon myself to thank him for changing so many of your lives too. You know, and while none of us can ever fully know our impact, I think we can agree, and this is what I tried to convince him, that Bobby's impact and his legacy is at this moment fully unknowable, but it's massive. I have a whole riff on all the things he did, and I'm going to skip it. Bobby heard all that. I also just want to say one thing. I skipped my whole beautiful section about Bernie, because Bobby and Bernie together, that duo, I don't know what to say. They were amazing. And then Will came along, and then Kent and others, but those three, wow. And Blake, yeah. Anyway, as we talked, and I did my best to articulate how much he meant to me, we talked, and the truth is, and I fumbled the transition, so forgive me. The truth is, in the end, Virginia and Orlando, all he really wanted to talk about was you. So thank you, Bobby. It's a better world because you were here.
Right. Back on X with turn, turn, out, in, jump, step, step, kick, kick, leap, kick, touch. Got it? Going on. And turn, turn, touch, down, back, step. A 5, 6, 7, 8, a turn, turn, touch, down, back, step. A 5, 6, 7, 8, a turn, turn, touch, down, back, step. Pivot step, walk, walk, walk. The last part is pivot step, walk, walk, walk. Viewing for the last turn. A 5, 6, 7, 8, a turn, turn, touch, down, back, step, pivot step, walk, walk, walk. Right. Okay, this is the whole combination, facing away from the mirror. From the top, a 5, 6, 7, 8! Combination one more time. Boys and girls, do it together, don't kill yourselves. Mark. A 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6.
The history that we have and the experience that we had doing this show will never compare to meeting any other company.
Let us.
I do a mean Tina Turner imitation.
I mean, I would like to be here with a success, obviously. And I'm grateful that the reviewers are very kind to me. But I'm telling you, the way to learn about the theater and the way to learn about yourself as an actor is to do things like I just did. Because that is the training ground, and I'm still young and learning, and that's the way I want to stay. I mean, successful actors who have not had that experience are missing something, let me tell you.
I understand what loneliness is, Marion.
This house is like a morgue. Liza's never home, and when she is, she acts like she hates being with me. She went out this morning, and I don't know where she's gone. I don't know when she'll be home, and I'm here by myself.
Let me comfort you. Come on.
Oh, Zach.
Marion, let me wash away those tears. Let me make love to you, Marion.
Yes. Oh, but Zach, not here. Downstairs, let's go. Let's go upstairs.
Fine. Marion.
Yes.
The same arrangement as before, right?
Same what?
You know, the same rate.
I don't believe your gall.
Marion,
you come into my house, oozing sympathy and playing on my emotions all for the same rate.
I want to help.
Look, get out of here. And don't you ever come back here again.
Haven't we done this before?
Zach, get out.
You don't mean that.
You are nothing but a cheap hustler. Now you get out of here and you stay out of here.
I guess it's just not my day.
Math, geography, earth sciences, subjects that come alive on the computer in a way they never could on the blackboard. My kids, they're more interested. I'm more interested. You learn something new every day.
Well, there goes the neighborhood. Glenn Schneider, 4A. I collect art.
Samantha Jones, 2D.
And I'm guessing you collect compliments.
Oh, Len, stop. Really, Len, stop.
Coach. 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 Come here.
Hey, Tone. How you doing?
Good, how you doing?
Fine, thanks. Listen, you know, that nickname.
What, Coos? Cusumano?
It's got that other connotation that...
No, not anymore. Listen, pal, I need a little solid. I need you to hang on to this for a while for me. Hang on to it, and a little while I'll come get it when I need it.
How long?
And what's this?
Dennis, my daughter. Allison, my friend, Dennis.
It's a pleasure to meet you, Allison. It's a real honor to be in the presence of such a powerful female lineage. Please, let me know if I can be of any service.
Can we give some privacy, please?
What I mean by art is I want to address the audience's issues and make them laugh or cry. I want something to cross the footlights into their hearts and souls so that they have a theatrical experience like aha, or they'll never forget. I'm sure you know what I'm talking about.
Mm-hmm.
That's what interests me.
That's the goal of all theater, and still is for me, because I think that's the most important aspect of theater that we can accomplish. We don't need money for that. We just need ideas, we need imagination, we need creativity.
I'm most interested in what happens to the audience after the show.
Mm.
Because I want them to go away. I mean, I want them to laugh a little, cry a little, they had a marvelous experience and all that stuff. But I want them to talk about or review in their minds what they just experienced, like collectively and individually.
Hi, I'm Didi Rea. I am Bobby's friend of over 40 years. It all started with Bernie. I represented Bernie as an actor. I booked him on Guiding Light, but he was an intrepid reporter for the National Enquirer. But then he introduced me to his friend Bobby. And Bobby and I have been dear friends since that moment. We had a very special bond. I'm almost as loud and obnoxious and opinionated as him. Maybe. And equally joyful. I want you to know that the whole way, even to the very end, we laughed. We laughed a lot. We found joy in everything. We held each other and talked to each other about what a good run we'd had. So it was an amazing experience, but I'm actually not here to talk about that. Nothing about me. I'm talking about his life upstate in Athens, New York, next to Coxsackie. There's a whole contingent of people here tonight from today, from that group. But Bobby bought a house and built a community in Coxsackie. A weird name of a town, but nonetheless. And community was everything. He would have Sunday brunches every Sunday, which were like church to some people. We would come and we would talk, and from a lot of people from a different walks of life would come there, and then Bobby would always wash the dishes. We'd go to dinner. We'd have an incredible meal cooked by Virginia. Bobby did the dishes again. And afterwards, as you've heard, he would dance. We would all dance. He would grab Virginia and dance around, and then we all sort of felt the motivation. And yes, there was interpretive dancing. But in this community, he did a lot of good works too. There's something called the cult. Is that my time? the Athens Cultural Center. And he taught a ballet class, of which I was part of whenever I was in town. It was called Follies with Bobby, Ballet and Other Smooth Moves for Women of a Certain Age and Confident Men. He was amazing. He taught us with all seriousness, but with so much love. There was a member of our group who recently passed away named Tim, an artist, and he had no rhythm at all. I mean, it's hard to believe this, but it was none. And Bobby encouraged him, and he was a major part of that dance group. And he was loved by all of us, and Bobby helped him just express himself however that was. Some of the other things were up there. He had a boat. His house was right on the Hudson. And Friday nights were always, in the summer, dinner at Bobby's and going on the boat. And there was nothing Bobby liked more than being on that boat, sailing down the Hudson, not sailing, motoring putt-putt, with a group of his friends and a beer in his hand. I think if you saw the pictures, there were quite a few of those. You know, another thing about Bobby upstate, when you went into his house, for whatever reason, he always gave you a compliment, no matter what. He greeted you at the door, and you consequently were, I do look good, thank you. Kind of set the tone for the whole thing. And after a big party there, when some of us were still around, hanging out, he would look at his group with widespread arms and say, I like us. And to me, that was a miracle. You also may know that I represented him as an actor, as a manager for 20 odd years, and don't blame me that he didn't work a lot. He was like, Bobby, I got this great gig for you. I'm not available. Bobby, do you want to? I do, Didi, I do, but I'm just not available. So we had this dual relationship, manager and friend, but friend trumped. I can't believe he's gone, but Virginia was kind enough, Virginia and Orlando, to share him with us his last months. And I spent a lot of hours lying next to him in the bed, holding his hand, and when he was verbal, talking about days, laughing. And he was himself right till the end, even when he had trouble talking. He was amazing. He was joyful, expansive, and there. And yes, he did blame all his faults on being an Italian. But he was a happy Italian. Anyway, thank you for letting me speak today. He was really an important part of my life, and so Virginia and Orlando are, and thank you for being here.
I'm Harry Horgan.
I'm Susie.
And we are the founders of Shake a Leg. It's a nonprofit organization that is dedicated to helping people with disabilities improve their independence and quality of life. We have a quick story about how we met Bob in 1988. It was during a time of crisis. Each summer, we run a body awareness training program that is focused on helping people with disabilities who want to improve their independence. We offer holistic therapies like Rolfing and Feldenkrais, physical therapy, sailing, dance. And in this particular year, a new program, a performing arts program. Disabled participants were challenged to write a personal vignette and then to perform it at a Shake Leg fundraiser under this big tent overlooking Newport Harbor. At 10 o'clock at night, 4 days before the performance, I get a call from Bill Zimmer. Bill is a founding member of Shake a Leg, a rolfer, a dancer, college professor, one of the mildest mannered people we know. Bill said, "Get over here right away." He was like a voice I've never heard. "Everyone's gonna quit. We won't have a show for the big fundraiser." I got right over there. The performance director was having a meltdown, and she was taking it out on all the participants. Bill and I asked, "What can we do? How can we help? How can we save the show?" She was silent and sobbing, and we're like, "Oh my God." And then all of a sudden we hear, "Bobby, Bobby." And she jumps up and she says, "Bobby LuPone will save the day." And she gets on the phone and tells him the situation. And he says, "I'll be up there tomorrow." And we're like, "Who is this guy?" So the next day we gathered in anticipation, and all of a sudden we see this red convertible BMW zooming up the driveway, dust blowing behind, his scarf blowing back, the music blasting, and he screeches to a stop, and he gets out, and he said, "I hear we have a show to produce." And we all just said, "Our superhero has just arrived." He quickly assessed the situation and said to all of us in an inspirational tone, "We can make this work." One of the first things he did was to call Bernie.
Bernie, you gotta get up here right away. It's a nightmare. All these people in wheelchairs, I don't know what to do. I'm overwhelmed.
So Bernie hopped on a train, and Susie picked him up.
Oh, Bernie, hello, so nice to meet you. Get in the car.
So the superhero and the sidekick arrived. They jumped into action. In 2 days, they pulled it all together. It was amazing. Bobby showed us how to speak and perform from our heart, and how we all have individual strengths, and we must work in harmony. Well, the performance was amazing. We exceeded everyone's expectations. Bobby and Bernie pulled it off. Participants left empowered, and the audience left having a greater appreciation of the possibilities of people with disabilities. Their work didn't end there. Bob and Bernie invited us to become part of the MCC, and for the next 7 summers, new plays were written and produced, new participants performed. We all learned from Bob and Bernie, as well as the MCC members. Will Cantler, Maureen Barnes, Linda Larson, Kent Adams, Karen Braga, Patrick Breen, Jackie Reingold, and Sandy Corbett, along with several others who volunteered their time creating performances, friendships, skills, and memories that live with us. This all started with Bob. We are very fortunate to have him. And MCC in our lives. He helped us believe in ourselves and inspired us to follow our dreams. His spirit will be with us forever. Orlando, you have his DNA. And Virginia, thank you for raising Bobby. We thank you, Bob LuPone. We love you.
Something strange but so familiar, something rare and beautiful has come. Beautiful has come. She is dawn, dressed in all the splendors of the eastern sky, scattering the darkness from indifference. Something strange and so familiar, something rare and beautiful has come. Beautiful has come. Now delight is ever present, you are here at last. Now my night won't be unpleasant. Now the moon will cast sandalwood and alabaster dreams away. bound my door. You are here and now I won't be lonely anymore. She is mine. Suddenly the sky is lapis lazuli. Suddenly the water pomegranate wine. Is it so or only seems to be? Something lost has now come back to me. Now that something beautiful has come to me.
Greetings to all of you, Virginia, Orlando, my MCC family. I so wish I could be there with you in person. Robert LuPone was a champion. He was my champion. I first met Bobby when I auditioned to take over for the amazing Kathleen Chalfont in the play Wind that the MCC team was producing with Daryl Roth. Bobby was supportive and welcoming. I hadn't been on stage for 22 years, and he was filled with such joy for my taking a leap of faith and coming back to the theater. His support was continuous, giving guidance all along the way. We became friends. He encouraged me to join the board of MCC, one of his greatest gifts to me. He was, and still is for me, a person of great substance, high integrity, fully present, an artistic whirlwind, always a powerful support, an intensely creative performer, a tough and generous teacher, and a laugh that could shake the light board of any theater. His dedication to his family always moved me, showed me more of who he was, what his priorities were, where he connected, and I can feel him now as I talk about him. Hearing him tell me to reach deep for a character, to take chances, make a wild commitment, an out-of-the-box choice, take a risk, and most importantly, embrace life, for it is fragile and brief and precious. A mentor, a friend, and an inspiration. Such a glorious human being. I will miss his presence in my life for the rest of my life.
How do we describe someone who was more alive even after his passing than so many of us who are still here? I'll start with the first time I saw Bob in person. It was on stage. He was walking the perimeter of the stage of Circle in the Square, and I remember this as if it happened yesterday, even though I was 15 years old. He immediately eclipsed the two actors wrestling for dominance center stage. There was no more wrestling for dominance as soon as Bobby entered. With his quiet, calm, and sturdy presence, he commanded the entire room. And to do so is a feat for anyone, especially if the actors you're diverting attention from are John C. Reilly and Philip Seymour Hoffman. But that's what Bob did. On stage and off, effortlessly, full of grace and ease, seeping with warmth. Your eye went to him and then your heart. He commanded your attention and then your respect, and then, of course, inevitably, your love. I'm not sure how he did it other than fully embodying his every moment. There was something undeniably present about him, and of course, this kind of presence, all too rare and deeply inspiring, calls us to join it and then to emulate it in every way we can. I got to move beyond fandom and into friendship with Bob when I was cast in Still Life at MCC 10 years after that production of True West. I was exuberant to get that job. I loved the part, the play, the cast, but most of all, I loved MCC. They had produced my favorite plays. They espoused an aesthetic that felt so deeply aligned with my own, and beyond all that, they were just cool. They were cool in the truest sense of the word, not unattainable or holier than thou, but warm, welcoming, inclusive. And Bob, of course, captured this spirit inimitably. Inimitably. His presence always reminded me of a high school kid who couldn't believe he got to make theater with his friends. I always felt seen and cherished by him, even though I had probably 17 lines in that play. I believe every member of that company and every company of an MCC play did. He was a leader and a gentleman. I have a piece of tissue on my face. It's hard to find both in one person. He was both and more. The thrill that I felt being cast in Still Life was unparalleled by the wonder I felt when MCC offered me a production of my play, A Funny Thing Happened, on the way to the gynecologic oncology unit at Memorial Sloan Kettering Cancer Center of New York City. Now I have to go, I've used up my time. Then giving me the space to explore and expand and then firmly establish my career as a playwright, first with that play and then 3 years later with Moscow Times 6. I shortened that one. MCC gave me a priceless gift, one that was encapsulated by Bob's almost childlike awe in what we were all making together. I really hope I never forget the first meet and greet we had with MCC donors and patrons after an early preview performance of Moscow. It was one of the first shows in MCC's incredible new space, and Bob sat with the entire cast eating empanada mama and gushing about how incredible it was to finally be here. Yes, of course, to be making theater that we cared about, but also, and perhaps more importantly, to be with each other, eating empanadas and celebrating the play, the space, each other. This is not to say that every moment collaborating with Bob was easy. I came to know him as the person whose notes would irritate me more than anyone else's. Whenever we would gather post read through or rehearsal or run, and Bob would say, "I have a question," I would brace myself, take a deep breath, and prepare to be annoyed. And then, of course, after I had tried to doggedly defend my position, I would eventually open up to the possibility that maybe Bob had a point. And I would try to really answer his question, and I would always realize that he was right in asking it, and that in answering it, our show would be better. And I learned from Bob that the most annoying questions are the ones to pay attention to, and that I too can ask annoying questions that need to be asked, as long as I do it with kindness and respect, the kind of kindness and respect that was intrinsic to Bob's presence. Just before his exit in True West, Bob's character, Hollywood agent Saul Kimmer, tries to persuade his client Austin to write a screenplay based on his derelict brother Lee's idea for a Western. "There's no such thing as the West anymore," Austin yells. "It's a dead issue. It's dried up, Saul, and so are you." "Maybe you're right," Saul replies. "But I have to take the gamble, don't I?" Thank you, Bob, for always taking the gamble, for every note, for all of it.
So very many people wrote us, as Blake said, and I do want to share just a couple of those notes. And please turn off your phone. First, from our longtime friend, Betsy Adam. "Right away, I remembered meeting Bob back at Circle Rep before ever stepping into your old MCC office on 42nd Street. He was rapid fire and engaging, and I had no idea what direction that would take." None of us did. "I have the fondest memories of my time at MCC on 28th Street, doing five women wearing the same dress, and how giddy you all were. in the nascent stages of being producers and excited that you had a plethora of actors in peach satin bridesmaids' dresses buzzing about. And all the years at the Lortel Theater, seeing him standing at the back of the house to be the greeter for every show I attended. And then, finally, your own space on 52nd Street, and his sense of pride, being the mayor of it all. I'll miss the accidental meetings that are what makes New York feel like New York. The idea of the quick, bright smile and the devilish glance in his eyes not greeting me across a room, no matter how much time has passed, makes me wobbly and mad that people that I adore keep disappearing. This came from Carrie Azzano, our director of education and outreach for 7 years until she moved out west in 2019. Mm. To Bob, who dreamed up the theater that brought me to New York, who wouldn't hesitate to meet with the youth company, see their work, probably cry, and definitely make an impromptu speech, who would reply to every email I sent, that's a lot of emails, with words of encouragement, who would have me pulling my hair out over something he said, often in an impromptu speech, but always be willing to talk through it and make changes. He interpreted danced when he decided it was better than words, and he walked on air for months around the new Hell's Kitchen space after crying, "We are here," when we opened the place. And he opened the doors of that home to the most beautiful community of young artists I'll ever know. Thank you, Bob. So, it was 1985. I had been in New York for 5 years, struggling for a foothold in the theater, and every bit of it felt hard, unsafe, and lonely. Then I met this fledgling, this nascent dream of a theater, Manhattan Class Company. And after hanging around for a few months, Bob and Bernie invited me on a marathon weekend. 40 or so of us piled into cars and headed to a ramshackle retreat house on Long Island. We read first drafts of new plays, and then we talked about them. We wolfed down our meals, and then we talked. We played charades late into the night, and we drank, and we talked, and no one, truly, no one talked more than Bob LuPone. If Bernie was the master strategist of our shenanigans, Bob was the great god Pan. Infectious and infuriating, cocksure and cracked. He inspired and provoked, and we talked and we talked and we talked. And the weekend ended, and I went home and I said to my wife, Jan, I think I've found a home. Bob often terrified me. There are a couple of us here who will never forget a rafting trip to rural West Virginia. When Bob spotted a high school fair and insisted we stop. A bunch of New York fancy pants walking into the local fair in a town of 700 was, shall we say, noticeable? And Bob was loving it, flirting with every man, woman, and child he met. When a paunchy fellow with a cool hand Luke drawl swaggered over to us, while a cop with a chain gang grimace stood back, a beaming Bob chose to lead with, "Now before I tell you who I am, who are you?" I died. But by the time the evening was over, the mayor of Gauley Bridge, West Virginia, had taken us to the town hall to share some history, slapped us all on the back, given us commemorative town pins, and sent us on our way with the "y'all come back now." I was in awe. And I am wearing that. There is a lot I could say about the artistic life we had together, but so much of that is already on the record. What is more profound is that Bob was much more than one of my two closest artistic collaborators. Bob was a part of Jan and David and Eve's and my family life, through births, graduations, and weddings, and more. After Bob and Virginia moved up to Athens, they became regulars at the annual Christmas party my brother Stoney and his wife Mary held at their home in East Hampton, Massachusetts. This was not a theater scene, and few, if any, people knew who he was, but by the time those afternoons were over, he could tell you a story about pretty much everyone who had been there. And then there was the year Bob and Virginia and Orlando joined the huge family and friends Thanksgiving potluck Stoney and Mary threw at the local American Legion post. The only drawback to the venue was that all alcoholic beverages had to be purchased down the hall at the post's bar, which was open on Thanksgiving Day. I remember vividly going to buy a couple of beers, and there was Bob standing at the bar next to a lonely barfly, watching the Macy's parade and lighting up this guy's day, shooting the shit with him about the finer points of the choreography on the memes. It was sweet and crazy and so fun. My sister-in-law put it into perspective. She said, wherever Bob was, whoever else was in the room, when you talked to Bob, he was never looking over your shoulder. He was talking to you. How very rare. Almost 40 years we worked together. It was passionate, it was messy, it was infuriating, it was thrilling. It was never dull. It was family. One of the last times I saw Bob, we sat holding hands, and he said to me, you know, Will, I didn't like you when I met you. Can you believe it? How about that? I still reach for that hand, and we talk, and we talk, and we talk.
Thank you. actually have some of my notes. All right. So a couple of things. Thank you for being here. I'll do some more thinking. I'm Virginia LuPone. I was married to Bob. I met him, 34 years ago. We bought our house upstate 26 years ago. We were married 24 years ago. We had Orlando almost 17 years ago. And some of you in this room had a whole life with him before I got there. And we are, all of us together, sharing this life with Bob. One of the things I want to say before I got to something I wrote, which is, you know, okay, is that Bobby was a family man. And I mean that in growing up in Long Island with his family and his friends and the family that he made there and kept his whole life. And as a dancer here at Juilliard, a gypsy doing shows, traveling the world, creating MCC and the family and the family of friends that are in this room and the family that we created. And he was a little reluctant to be a father, actually. He was very worried that it was going to be all about Orlando. And one of the things about Bob is he was not shy about, you know, saying that. He was honest, you know, in a way. And the thing that shocked him the most was that became everything to him. And he worried that he would take jobs because he had to help his son. He would worry that everything would become about his son. And you know, he loved that more than anything. And he found himself deeply and richly when he realized, indeed, he was a family man. He'd been creating family his whole life. And he felt very fulfilled by the family that we created and that we feel very much a part of in this room here. Upstate, we have that community and our friends and our family. There's some people from Orlando School, where I teach now, where Orlando's been going to school since he was three, and where Bob was very, very active. Thank you guys for coming and being here with us. I'm gonna try to share a little bit of what that life was like, since a lot of you know other things. And this is the so-so writing part, so, you know. So there's just sharing moments with Bob on Formal Point. Floating on the Hudson, drifting with friends, swimming with the dog, pulling the kids on a float. Bob, our captain, smiling with his red baseball cap pulled low, trying to flip the kids into the water with each turn of the wheel. Every swing, getting the lawnmower stuck in the mud, and then the truck stuck as well, trying to pull it out, knowing it was too wet to snow, and laughing at his own impatience. Dancing in the kitchen on weekends, and while driving in the car, and in a store, at a party, on the street, in class, under his watchful eye. In the fall, Bob was chainsawing trees, splitting logs, stacking wood for winter, and insisting I inspect his work. Driving Orlando to school, driving him home again, joining the arts committee, making changes. He turned a school into our extended family and another home for our son. As I walk through the halls, I hear, "Say hi to your husband." "How is your husband?" "I just love your husband." "I miss your husband." Bob stripping naked, skinny dipping, whenever he thought the party needed a bit of controversy. Parties filled with friends, family, and strangers he met on a train. shared food, and joyous laughter. After doing the dishes, Bob slips away to be with Orlando, yelling for us to hurry up, making us wait, fighting about nothing and everything, talking and crying until we get right again. Sitting on the porch, waving at neighbors, sharing drinks with friends, watching the river. Orlando at the kitchen table, explaining math, explaining science, explaining anime. With a laugh, Bob saying, "Son, I don't get it." Orlando laughing back, "I know, Dad, it's okay." 20 feet off the ground, painting the house, a side a year. With 1 foot balanced on the rung of a ladder, which is perched precariously on the bed of a pickup truck wedged against the house. Defying gravity. His head on my shoulder, nestling in our flannel sheets, sharing our secrets of the day. He holds me close and says, "This is my favorite place in the world, right here on your shoulder." Right, that's. There's too much to say, too much to share, you guys know. I want to thank you for being here. I want to thank all of you that spoke so beautifully to us, for us. The songs, the dance, MCC. So many of you came, called, texted, sent food, sent love, sent food. Catered events, managed people, put waterproof mascara on my front porch, and more food, holding hands with Bob, taking us places, driving Orlando wherever he wanted to go, making sure he was fed when we couldn't be there, sending gummies, you know who you are. The doctors, the nurses, the friends, the family. It is too much for remember. I actually had it written down when I left it over there. But, because it's too many. And I don't know how to thank you all for what you have given to us, how you've shown the love that I don't think Bobby even realized how deeply he was loved. It was his nature not to, ironically, realize that. I want to, however, before I leave here, I want to say that a couple of you have thanked me for today. And I appreciate that, but I did not do this. Bernie did this for us. Yeah, I'm done. Me and Orlando, but Bob loved Bernie so much. And that friendship, that relationship, that brotherhood was a core of who he was. And Bernie was his family. And can't thank you enough, Bernie. Thank you for coming. And that's all. Thank you.
Doing really well till she said that. You said the Xanax would still be working.
Good afternoon. And Will, I swear he promised me he was not going to tell you that. The classic Bob, he had to go tell you that. It is so wonderful to see so many of Bob's friends and family here today, especially those who traveled great distances to be here. I know Bobby would be smiling seeing so many of the MCC family, especially those from the early days of the mid-80s. Seems like yesterday. Seeing those clips of Bobby, listening to everyone's stories and anecdotes has been so moving. But being here today in person, sharing this with all of you and the celebration of his life, that's the third act that Bobby always talked about. I've been reading all the letters and the posts and the tweets that have been coming in over the last months. They've all been time capsules of beautiful and funny stories that have brought Bobby's life back in person. I've also watched every single one of those All My Children clips. I'm really happy that one went over big, because late at night I'd be like, this one? No, this one. Everyone in that town was a suspect for wanting to kill him. And it's like they gave every principal the best last scene to make it feel like they were the murderer of Zach Grayson. I was with him during those days where, like, we'd go on white water rafting trips and, you know, this was our friendship. We weren't so heavy into the theater yet. And he would get spotted, you know, from everyone because of who shot Zach Grayson. It was the daytime soap opera JR. But I couldn't believe I was up all night watching those clips. I'd like to share two more letters that have come in that I thought also captured and celebrated Bob. So bear with me for a second. This is from Kevin Klein. I thought about Bobby's performance in Tooth of Crime as I recollected some peak moments of knowing him. The amazing thing he did, moving across the stage, springing to a standing position from a kneeling position, from sitting back on his heels. It was impossible and indelible and defied all previous laws of gravity and kinetics. And to me, it reflected, if not defined, his adventurous, extraordinary spirit. I also vividly recall crashing at his place in LA during the run of A Chorus Line when I flew out for an audition and landed with the flu. He was so generous and hospitable. Why are my memories so vivid? Because he was. Thanks, Patty, for sharing that. And this is from Susan Rannan, who was our chairwoman for the last 14 years at MCC. Although we had been expecting this intellectually, it was somewhat impossible to be emotionally prepared. Bob was a model of the heart and soul of MCC. Feisty, demanding, dedicated, and always deeply caring of those whom he engaged. His warmth and laughter permeated the room, and he always was ready to laugh at himself, a trait that cannot be undervalued. I was with him in his last few weeks, and even in his discomfort, he radiated the same warmth and generosity of spirit. This is deeply a personal loss, but I believe his spirit will never leave us. I will be looking for his smiling face. Thanks, Susan. Some of you know the story of mine and Bobby's first meeting. Patrick hinted at it, but here it goes. It was 1981, and it was my last semester at NYU, and my fellow students and I were looking forward to this master acting class with Jack Garfine. Jack was the founder of the Actors and Directors Lab studio where we were studying through NYU. Additionally, he was a protege of Harold Klerman, the legendary founder of the group theater who we had all been studying. Jack was a formidable figure, and we'd all been looking forward to meeting him for 3 years. It was our last semester. And in walks Robert LuPone. He starts the class by telling us, I'm not sure why I'm here, and you should know I have never taught before. Our faces fell, anticipation turned into irritation. We were asking ourselves, is this why I'm killing myself at two work-study programs at NYU? Well, as I've come to learn over the years, never underestimate the abilities of Bob LuPone. He was a natural. He was exactly what we needed, and so much, so much better than what we expected. We looked forward to that class for the remainder of the semester, and seven of us, five who are all here today, continued training with Bob over the next 2 years. Upon graduating, I was able to hustle a free space at NYU over the summer until they realized Bob was no longer a teacher, so they kicked us out. And we moved up to his apartment, as Patrick said. That class became the foundation of MCC and our friendship for 42 years. No one can prepare you for losing someone so important in your life. It's painful when a friendship is reduced by half. The friendship and artistic partnership that we shared was based on respect, trust, and mutual admiration. That was the sustained bond forged between us all those years ago back at NYU. Others today have shared how impactful and extraordinary Bob was as a friend, an artist, a teacher. He taught me so much. One of the traits I learned from him early on was always to say yes. He would say, yes, yes I can, yes I will, yes we can, or yes, cause why not? Here are a few moments of Bob saying yes that really stay with me. After being in class with him for over a year, I said, hey Bob, I always dreamed about starting a theater company. You wanna do it together? To my surprise, Bob said, yes. He said, I don't know what I'm doing, but I'm back in a chorus line, so come up to the Schubert Theater, I'll tell the house manager to let you in after the show starts, and after the opening number, between my cues, we can map out starting the theater. I need to repeat that, right? It was unreal. He says, after the opening number? Did you see that opening number? Well, being who I was, I quickly got friendly with the house manager so I could slip in right before the opening number so I too can watch it every night. We would talk and talk at the back steps of the Schubert Theater, and I, of course, would have anxiety that he was gonna miss one of his cue lines after one of the other members were singing their songs, and he would say, oh, it's okay if I miss it. It adds to the tension and the suspense. That's the tension and suspense that they're supposed to be feeling. They're not supposed to know what happens next or who gets called next. That's real, Bernie. I mean, there were many times I was going to recite the line for him. Thus began the tradition of standing in the back of the theater of summits with me and Bob. We were a good pair. He loved physical labor, and I loved administrative tasks. For example, when we first moved into MCC in the Flower District, we had to remove a huge window AC unit to prevent the theater from falling into perpetual deep freeze during the winter. Everyone said, it's too big, it's too heavy to move out, except you know who. Bob said, yes, that's easy, I can get it out. To his credit, he did. He got the unit and himself right out the second floor window, gracefully falling on top of a row of rose bushes on 28th Street. Thank God we were in the Flower District where the local hospital was used to removing 50 thorns from a patient's crotch. Oh, there are so many. Like Peter, for an extra fundraising, we could have a night of stories. But there are less thorny times where Bob said yes. Like when he said, Bern, I gotta tell you something. Yes, I'm going to marry the love of my life, Virginia. Right after you marry Ann. Or years later when Orlando was going on his first date and he said, yes, my boy is dating! I'm so excited! He was so excited, I don't mean to embarrass you. Orlando, since my boys are older than you, I always loved hearing all of your dad's stories about your many milestones, and I hope I will get to continue to hear them. We are all here for you. I hope you're as proud as your dad as he was of you. You know, when we considered where to have this ceremony, our first thought was obviously MCC, we have a new building, but soon we realized we didn't have enough space to fit the innumerable friends and family who would want to celebrate his life, and I am so touched to see all of you. The fact that we needed an auditorium is a testament to how impactful he was. Juilliard felt like a poetic place and a poetic choice is where his artistic career began. And we thank everyone at Juilliard for having us here today. You know, spending 40 years with someone creates a lot of shared stories, even in our last month. And I will forever cherish those stories, those memories that we shared. They are Bobby's way of remaining part of our lives, even today. Every day I'm reminded of him through a phase, a memory, or even a gesture. There are things that keep him close in mind and spirit as I know he is still right by my side. I can see him standing in the back of the theater after one of the MCC shows, waiting to talk about the show or about what he has to get back to in Athens. I am so grateful for having met him and better for having knowing him. I know I'm a better man for having had such a wonderful friend. I'll end with something I'm just learning now through this time. People don't talk about grief a lot. In fact, it's so rarely talked about and yet it's a need we will all have to deal with in our lives. And if we're lucky, in a strange way, it only means we have lived to experience the loss of someone that we really loved, or have been loved enough that it deeply affects you. And Bob, Bob was that person for me. And now here is Bob, in his own words, followed by Eleri Ward to close us out. Thank you.
I've lived and I've loved and I've gained and I've lost all those things. And I think that's one of the great joys of being an artist and one of the great joys of being in the theater in New York. And we don't do theater for ourselves. We do theater because of the theater. And there's a joy in that. And there's a grace in that. And there is a mission in that. What you can trust is that I look at you, you look at me, we play a part. I look at you, you wrote this, we can trust the work. That's the one thing you can trust. Amidst all of the crazies, amidst the need to survive, amidst the loves and the breakups, amidst the failures and the successes, the work is the key. It takes courage, tremendous courage, because you don't know what you're doing. It takes faith that you do know what you're doing. It takes will that you can overcome all the no's, and ultimately, you have to have a vision of what's important for you and for the theater. That's what the joy of being in the theater is about. That's the joy of putting up with all of this. You have those moments. Besides just being a hit, that's great news, right? We all want a hit because it means so much. But beyond even that idea of a hit, that moment where the sphere of influence of theater is beyond the composite parts and beyond even the audience's understanding. It's something that's about, it's tribal, it's universal, it's ancient, it's in our souls, and we carry it forever. That's the place that we touch every now and then, and it makes it all worthwhile. I'm filled with this sense of accomplishment and a sense of happiness about where MCC is, what it's accomplished, and what it now has in terms of a home factory, where the idea of turning out issue, substantial, aesthetic, artful, funny, humorous, entertaining, all of those things, despite the cost. There's no better life than a life in theater in New York City, with the community, with the ups and the downs, with the fullness of life and creativity that you experience, both positive and negative, with the joys and sorrows of inspiration. That's the guideposts. That's the reason to do any of this. It's a great life. It's a great life.
Trees, or a river. yellow red water. Violet mass of the grass in our perfect park, made a flex of light and dark and parasols, people strolling through the trees of a small suburban park on an island in the river. On an Sunday.